Greetings, my name is Nina Gilreath, and this is episode number 5, Brown Sugar Ballerina Takes the Stage. In this episode, I want to talk about the impact of teaching brown and black girls and other girls and bringing classical ballet to metropolitan Atlanta as a young dancer. Recently, I read the interview, well, Carla Tyson's portion of When Will Black Ballerinas Take Center Stage that Chandra Whitfield wrote for the AJC. And I had a great epiphany. And the epiphany is that for someone like Carla, she grew up at Ballethnic where, as we started out to do, we wanted to be as founders and dancers in the forefront and not in the background. So as a black ballerina, I realized from hearing her interview that really we had set the benchmark very high and that we had achieved our goal. Because as I heard Carla talk, and she talked about seeing me dance and being her role model as a ballerina, and that's who she saw growing up on stage as I performed Brown Sugar and other variations, that made me feel really good. Because it made me see that my work was not in vain. So in the prime of my career, as well as Mr. Waverly, we just left the Atlanta Ballet and decided we wanted to use dance to make a tremendous impact on the community. We wanted to have a professional black ballet company. We wanted to be leads. We didn't want to be in the back. We wanted stories about ourselves. Stories about our culture and about being African Americans. And what we didn't realize is that at that time, that was pretty revolutionary. We were in our 20s and we really were very entrepreneurial. We didn't really know about the business of dance. We knew about being dancers. And in fact, we tried to get Lewis Johnson to come and start the company, but he was like, he was too old. And he was like, you guys can do it, but we didn't want to do it. But he was like, you know the best part of it, you know the dance. So we stumbled through many of the business aspects, but the good thing is that we always tried to get people who were older, seasoned, and had the wisdom, and we were always seeking knowledge. But again, leaders, being a leader at that time was tough. Because when I grew up as a dancer, most of my teachers were white. And I really felt like that they did not see me as being capable or able to be a ballerina. Because when you look at somebody and it doesn't reflect who you are, that's really a distancing of what the dream can potentially be. So my intentionality was to be that person that young brown and black and other girls could look and see and say, hey, if she can do it, I can do it too. That was always very important to me. And then the other thing that was important was that my students could become better than what I could do. Because I started dance at a later age. I started at 13 because the opportunity was not there when I was younger. So I knew that if my students started younger, they could get there faster and they could achieve higher goals. So that was important to me. So again, in really the dancing prime and my dancing prime, I consciously set out to say, hey, I wanna make this change. I wanna make this impact. I know that God gave me a talent. I always knew that I had the talent of dance and that I was always a dancer because from very young, I was always dancing. I just did not have technical training. What my gift was early on when I didn't have the technique is that I was a great performer and people could definitely see that when I hit the stage that I lit up, that I enjoyed it. And then another one of my superpowers is that I have a lot of energy. So when I hit the stage, and early on I knew I might not be the best technically, but people noticed me because I just came with this excitement about being on the stage. And the magic of being on the stage, every time I danced, I realized I was realizing my dream every time I got onto the stage. So that was a sense of joy for me. And during those early years, that's what I brought to the stage, because really there were a lot of critics in metropolitan Atlanta. People were saying, why do we need a black professional ballet company? Why can't you people just be satisfied with staying over at the Atlanta Ballet? Why can't you just do this? We don't need that. But we felt quite the opposite. We felt, because we were in a region where there were millions of people that look like us, that there should be a professional cultural outlet where people could dance classically if they desired. And that's what we did. So the early days really was going around and bringing enrichment everywhere that we could get to, and all the housing projects and all the schools and the churches. Waverly and I, we were just always out there performing some pas de deux or all kinds of dances. And it was tough because we were really a two-person show and we did everything. And then eventually we started to gain traction where people wanted to help us and they wanted to see what we were doing. And then we started to get little girls and boys following us because we had that hard work that they could see, and a family value. When people saw us, they saw a young couple, they saw people who were dedicated and loyal to their craft. So eventually family said, that's important. I want to be around people who have a great belief in the community and a great belief in what they do, and lovers of the arts and culture. So again, I started out teaching wherever I could, ballet, playing ballet music, and then spinning in some R&B music with that. And it simply worked. And some of the places that I was able to teach, some of the other teachers did not believe that the black girls were ready for point work. And I really totally went against what they thought. And I put a whole crew of black girls on point that were capable. They just weren't given the chance at 11 and 12. And eventually that became my first group and core of Flowers and Snow when we started Urban Nutcracker. So what I did see is that the belief and the opportunity just created this ripple effect that just continued to grow throughout the history of Ballethnic. The early years, every year we gained more momentum and more momentum because there was not the professional outlet. There was not an Urban Nutcracker. There was the Nutcracker then, because we started Urban Nutcracker way back in 1989 as a way to bring that cultural outlet of expression. So before that, our kids would see the Nutcracker, but they didn't see themselves on the stage. They didn't see the story about themselves. They might see one or two of us on stage, because again, when I was at the ballet, I was the one and the two, or the one or the two in Nutcracker. So I know what that feels like to be a token, even though I had the same talent, the same pedigree, the same credentials. I always knew that I was only gonna go so far. So my desire, along with Waverly, was to create a place where the sky was the limit, and that the people that came into Ballethnic, if they had that same value system, that they could be part of that foundation and build and be the people in the front and never have to feel like I'm a token in the back. But again, that comes with a great price. It's a lot of sacrifice. It's a lot of hard work. It's a great deal of not listening to people who don't believe in your ability to create something that's long lasting. And here we're about to celebrate 31 years, January 15th. So for all the naysayers, I'm just gonna say happy anniversary to Ballethnic. 31 years of staying on point, staying on task. And we have all the generations of dancers that have come through Ballethnic. And particularly, we have dancers that have come up through our Academy of Dance that have been able to be apprentices and eventually company members. I had a funder say to me one time, He was like, there are larger organizations that have not had the percentage of success of people coming through their school and being in their company. We've done it time and time again. It's been difficult because our value system is really top notch and we're hard workers. Our standards are high. We don't change our standards. And it's a hard place to be a lot of the time. And many times as a Black founded business, we don't get the funding like other organizations, even though we've checked all the boxes that people have told us that we have to check. We've done all the things that people have required us to do, and still there's the struggle. But I realize that a lot of Black businesses have that same struggle. But for me, it's just every day staying true to my personal mission and the mission as co-founders of what we believe the possibilities are for Ballethnic. Even at 31 years, we believe the possibilities are great. And now at this time in history, it's looking now where we are, but looking forward and creating opportunity for the legacy to live on through all the people that have come through Ballethnic and looking to the next leadership. This stage of my life is quite exhilarating to be able to use all the knowledge that I've gained by being an arts professional for many decades and to be able to share that with people throughout the state of Georgia, especially with the Athens to Atlanta artistic pipeline. I really love being able to show dancers in Athens that they can come to Atlanta, to East Point, to Fulton County to study and to train. And one example is one of our male students from Athens, Zion. He has been able to come to Ballethnic regularly on Saturdays and train with other guys and other people his age that are very, very serious about dance. So that makes me really, really happy to see his level of commitment and the support of his parents and his family that really stick behind him and want him to be able to have this extra experience, not only here in Athens, but in Atlanta and in other places, other spaces, because as dancers grow, they really do need other mentors, and especially males need to see other males dancing. They need to be trained by other males. And then what is exciting is that he brings back the energy, the seriousness, the commitment back to Athens, and he shares it with the students. So that is really impacting the community in a very, very positive way. And it's the same with the young ladies who have an opportunity for that same training. We've had girls come on the weekends or to workshops in Atlanta and study and to take the extra master classes. So that's exciting. As well as many of the students from Ballethnic have come to Athens and they performed with the dancers from East Athens Educational Dance Center. They performed on the Morton stage and at the dance center in the presentation hall for the Taste of Holiday, that event and the annual production. So it's this whole synergistic relationship that's happening, as well as them being able to dance with some of the dancers that I've taught or set choreography on at the University of Georgia. So that is really building a huge alliance and a bigger network of dancers and dance professionals. And I really enjoy mentoring and working with Ronnie Anderson, who's a graduate of the University of Georgia, and really using his expertise, not only in dance, but in advertising and other elements to build what we're doing throughout the region as well. So that's really been an important aspect. And then as he has gained more experience in choreographing and teaching, he's been able to take dancers from East Athens and see dancers from Ballethnic and go over to the Day of Dance at UGA. So we're really building a greater network, and then we've expanded that network by participating in the International Association of Blacks in Dance, and then taking all that information and traveling nationally, and then bringing all that information back to all of our prospective places. So one of our latest experiences during COVID is that Ballethnic was producing Urban Nutcracker, and some of the students from East Athens wanted an opportunity to perform. So because we're in such an innovative phase, we were able to incorporate dancers from here through a video project, and we were able to film the battle scene at the Morton Theater. And of course, we were socially distanced, and we had the magic of James Preston, who is a local videographer here. He is amazing. He is able to capture like all the dynamics of the choreography and bring just a cool spin on what we were doing. So luckily, Lynn Green was able to get us into the space so that we could film. And then Stephen was really great, Stephen Werner, with getting all the technical aspects. The dancers, we were able to teach them the choreography. Mr. Ronnie was able to learn it off of the videotape and then find out steps from others when he needed. And to get some of the University of Georgia teachers that teach tap to work on the tap elements, and to really, really work through an exciting collaboration from all of those entities to create a great version of the battle scene that's part of the streaming film version of Urban Nutcracker. So again, me being able to have this regional approach and really to reach more populations is really exciting. And I feel like it's really beneficial for everyone involved because I've been in the field for a long time. And one of the things that I really love to do is I like to share information. So it's an exciting time. I look forward to more innovative collaborations. And now we just are continually looking for more resources to create all the magic that I think we can make possible.